day, Great Wolf learners. Welcome to today's tourism lesson. My name is Lumka Mgotyelwa. This lesson is brought to you by the Northern Cape Department of Education in collaboration with Phakama Research and Development. Great Wolf learners, as you can see, today we are going to do foreign exchange. So you know foreign exchange is in question 3 of your prelim and your final question papers. The only topic that is asked in question 3. Meaning that now, grade 12 learners, when you get to question 3, you must get there prepared to answer everything that has got to do with foreign exchange. So foreign exchange does not only talk about calculations, or we're not only doing calculations under foreign exchange. There is a lot of terminology, a lot of concepts, a lot of information that you need to study before you can even get to the calculation. So today we are going to do the concepts. After doing the concepts, then we can get to the calculations on foreign exchange. So I want to believe that today you are only going to add one or two things on top of what you've done already in foreign exchange, because I want to believe that the topic was dealt with, the whole topic was done, and remember, grade 12 learners, you are coming from grade 11 with this topic. So I'm confident enough that at the end of this lesson, you are going to be able to explain the term gross domestic product and its benefits to the South African economy. So meaning that now it is important for you grade 12 learners to know what gross domestic product is, and also how does it benefit our South African economy. And then you must be able to explain the term multiplier effect. Multiplier effect was well explained in grade 10, grade 11, and then you see it again in grade 12. So meaning that now you can see these concepts or terminology, they keep coming back from the previous grades. So you see them now in grade 12. So it means they are important and you need to know them. And also you must be able to differentiate between the concept weak and a strong rand. What happens when the rand is strong? What happens when the rand is weak? How do you see that the rand is strong now when you're looking at the exchange rates? And how do you see the rand is weak? So we're going to talk about that in this topic. And also, you must be able to explain the difference between the BVR and the BSR. Remember, grade 12 learners, before you can start with your calculations, you must know the difference between the BVR and the BSR, because you are going to see them in your currency exchange rate, currency rate sheet. So you did them in grade 11. This is just a revision sort of in grade 12. And also you must be able to interpret the currency rate sheet. What is the currency rate sheet? It is what you always see in your question paper before you can start with the calculations, that table of foreign currency with the country, sometimes the currency code, the currency symbol, the BVR and the BSR, that is the currency rate sheet. So you must be able to interpret the currency rate sheet even before you start doing your calculations. And then lastly, you must be able to do calculations on foreign exchange. Remember, I said to you, we're starting with all the terminology. After doing all the terminology that goes together with the calculations, and then we'll get to the calculations, because the terminology also gives you a lot of marks, grade 12. So when you're talking forex, please do not only look at the calculations or look forward to do the calculations. The examination guideline 2021, if you go to it, it will tell you in section B which questions are you answering. There is question 2, there is question 3, and question 4. That is your section B. So you need to know exactly what is it that you are going to answer in question 3 when we're talking of a foreign exchange. And then the pre-knowledge grade 12 learners, this is telling you that the topic was dealt with in grade 11. There was a topic, a whole topic of foreign exchange. So many things were explained in grade 11 as opposed to grade 12. So there's a lot of terminology that was done in grade 11, and also some has been carried over to grade 12, but there is also new terminology that you have started doing under this topic in grade 12. So hence I'm saying to you, this topic is not new to you. Now, at grade 12, we are going to look at the terminology now. It's important terminology. Each of these terms, they are very important, and you need to take them very serious. I've seen many question papers whereby before you do the calculations, maybe it says, explain what is fluctuation, explain what is multiplier effect, what are the benefits of multiplier effect. So there's a lot. Explain what is BVR, explain what is BSR. So one or two concepts, you will see them in your prelim. You will also see them in your final exam. So it is important to take this terminology very serious, grade 12 learners. Let's go again to a gross domestic product. What is gross domestic product? It is commonly known as GDP. We usually abbreviate gross domestic tourism as GDP. It is the market value of all officially recognized final goods and services produced in a country within a given period, usually a calendar year. So if it has to do with each and every goods that are officially recognized, that are produced in South Africa within a period of a year, we're talking goods and services produced in South Africa within a period of 1 year, then you will be talking of gross domestic product. So when you're talking about gross domestic product, you're also mentioning tourism there. It is part of the goods and services that are actually being produced in a year, and there is money that they actually, these industries are contributing, or the businesses that are contributing to the tourism industry. So the tourism industry, you must take it serious, grade 12 learners. It is known as a new gold industry because it contributes a lot to the GDP of the country. You have different industries, but tourism is another industry that is actually contributing a lot of percentage to the GDP of the country. So the second term here, it is multiplier effect. So multiplier effect is the effect that any extra spending has on the GDP. Any extra spending has on the GDP. Each time that money is spent, everyone involved in the production and sale benefits. So in tourism, what are we saying in essence? In tourism, we are saying if we have a tourist, because initially we're getting the money from the tourist. So if we have a tourist that has visited a destination, that tourist is going to make use of our goods and services, meaning that he or she is going to spend money on our goods and services. Who is providing the goods and the services to the tourist? It is the people who are working for those different businesses in the tourism industry. So those people are employed. So if those people are employed, they're getting salaries and wages. What are they doing with their salaries and wages? They spend their money because they have their own budgets. They even pay taxes to the government. So when you explain multiplier effect, it will go down up until it benefits the local community at the end of the day. So that money initially, where is it coming from? That money came from a tourist when we're talking about multiplier effect in the tourism industry. That is why now we are saying Each time that money is spent, everyone involved in the production and sale benefits. So everyone actually benefits. You can imagine if you're talking of a tourist who's going to use a hotel. So in the hotel, remember the tourist must eat. Where do the hotel owner get his fruits maybe and vegetables? From someone. So that person is going to be paid by the hotel owner, and then that person is going to supply the hotel with fruits and vegetables. So that person is also benefiting. The people who are working in that hotel are also benefiting. You see, the money that they spend after getting their salaries and their wages, maybe they pay for education, they pay for groceries. The people in the grocery wholesales, they also benefit. So I usually say to my learners, in simple terms, multiplier effect is a circulation of money from one hand to another, because in the process, everyone involved is going to benefit. And initially, I'm repeating this grade 12, initially the money came from a tourist in our case. And then another important term, it is the strong rand. What happens when the rand is strong? What are the disadvantages? What are the advantages? What are the benefits? So you need to know all of those. So a rand is strong when it gives a tourist less rands. So it, usually here, we're talking of our foreign tourists. So when they visit South Africa and they find that the rand is strong, obviously, when the rand is strong, it is going to give them what? It is going to give them less rands. You need to take that to the grade 12 learners, because now the question will be, how do you see when the rand is strong? How do you see when the rand is weak? I will make an example here. I have two exchange rates. Currently, like yesterday's exchange rate of a rand against a South African rand. Yesterday, it was 17 rand 99 cents. That is the current exchange rate of a rand against a US dollar. And then now, let's say today, it is 17 rand 50 cents. Now, my grade 12 learners must be able to tell me, between these two exchange rates, which one is showing us that the rand is strong and which one is showing us that the rand is weak? So this one, you see, it is 17 rand 99 cents. So it shows that the rand is weak there. So the foreign tourist, when he comes to South Africa, he is going to get more rands because the rand is weak. But if now you see there, it is 17 rand 50 cents. So this one is going to get less rands. So if he or she is getting less rands, it shows to us that the rand here is strong. So it is a confusion that our learners are still making of not being sure when the rand is weak, when the rand is strong. So you always check the exchange rate. So the exchange rate that shows that that this money is low than this one. So it means here the rand is strong and here the rand is weak. So a rand is weak. If you're looking at weak rand now, a rand is weak when it gives a tourist more rand. So this one here is going to give tourists more rands. And then this one is going to give tourists less rands. So what does that mean, grade 12 learners? It means that this one shows that the rand is strong and this one is showing to us that the rand is weak. I hope you are getting what I'm trying to explain to you. And then the next terminology or the next term is bank selling rate. You know, it is known as the BSR that you always see in your currency exchange rate table. It is the rate at which the bank sells foreign currency. When you're talking of BBR and BSR grade 12, you're talking a bank. We are explaining them from the bank's perspective. What is it that the bank is doing at that time? Is the bank selling or the bank buying the foreign currency? We're not talking of a tourist. Remember, if you are a tourist, you go to the bank to exchange your currency. We're not looking at your perspective when we're explaining BBR and BSR, but we're looking at the bank's perspective. What is the bank doing at that time? So a bank selling rate now is the rate at which the bank sells foreign currency. And also, a bank buying rate is the rate at which the bank buys foreign currency. So now the bank is buying here. And here, the bank is actually selling. So in most cases, grade 12 learners, let's say you are a South African tourist and you're visiting London. And when you're visiting London, obviously, you are going to need pounds. Remember, I'm saying you are a South African tourist, but you are intending to visit London. You will go to the bank. You will go to the bureau de change to exchange the currency. Which currency will you be exchanging at that time? Remember, in your hand, as a South African, you will be having your rands. So when you go to the bank with rands in your hand and you want to convert them, now the question that you need to ask yourself, what is the bank going to do? You go to the bank with your rands, but you want to visit London. So before you can visit London, you just want to convert your South African rands. So the bank is going to sell. You see now, grade 12. The bank is going to sell those foreign currencies to you. I hope you do understand that. If we were to look at the perspective of a tourist at that time, we were going to say the tourist is going there to buy and the bank is selling. Why are you buying as a tourist? It is because you want to buy these foreign currencies or these pounds and use them in the UK when you get to UK. So now we're looking at the bank's perspective. What is the bank going to do at that time? The bank is going to sell the foreign currency to you. Now, let's assume now that you are back from UK. Remember here, you have to go to the bank to buy foreign currency so that the bank can sell to you. Remember, I said you're looking at the perspective of a bank. It is the bank that is actually saying, selling to you, because you are desperate now. You want to go to UK. You want to use those pounds when you get there. You don't want to be stranded. Now, when you come back from UK, you have a surplus of these pounds. And then when you have a surplus of these pounds, grade 12 learners, now within 30 days, you can exchange them. But if 30 days passes, then you are going to keep them just as an exhibit that you went to that country or you went to, yes, you went to that country. So now, what if you want to exchange the surplus that you came back with of these pounds? What is the situation now? You go to the bank. You're selling those pounds as a tourist. But remember, grade 12, I said you're not looking at the perspective of a tourist. I'm just explaining so that you are clear. Now, what is the bank going to do? Because you're the one now who is having the foreign currency. The bank is going to buy from you. You see now, the bank is going to buy from you. Remember, grade 12 learners, when we say we're always looking at the perspective of a bank, remember, you went to the bank with your SA rands to do what? To buy. And the bank did what? Sold the currency to you. And then now, when you come back, you still go to the bank. What are you having now with you? Pounds. What are you going there to do? You are there to sell. And what is the bank going to do? It is going to buy from you. Buying what? Foreign currency. When you went for the first time, the bank sold you a pound, which is a foreign currency. When you went there with your surplus, your remaining pounds, because you are not going to use them in South Africa, then you go to the bank, and the bank is doing what? The bank is buying them from you. So what is it that the bank is doing in this case of this one tourist? The bank sold you pounds, and then the bank again is buying what? The pounds from you as a tourist. You see now, I also want to believe that you get what I'm trying to explain here, grade 12 learners. Then let us go to the next term, which is buying power. So when we're talking of a buying power in the past, when you explain buying power, you would explain it as a credit. Like if you have an account maybe at Foschini, you have an account at Mr. Price. And then when you go there, you want to know how much can I buy for in my account. Then the person will answer to say your buying power is 1,000 rand, meaning that it is the budget that you have that you can use. I don't want to use the word budget, but I'm just explaining this. It is the amount of money, in fact, that you have in your card, in your Foschini card or Mr. Price card that you can use at that time. So depending now whether the buying power is low or the buying power is high, if they give you a lot of money to buy, it means that your buying power at that time is high. But if they give you low money or low amount to buy, it means your buying power is low. You won't have enough money to spend. But when you have a high buying power, you will have enough money to spend. So now let us look at the buying power. It is the amount of money that a unit of currency can buy in another country as compared to the value in one's own country. So meaning that now we can make an example of a tourist who is coming from USA. I said USA currently, yesterday's exchange rate was 17 rand 99 cents. Now you can imagine if this person has got maybe $5,000, and then you convert the $5,000 into a South African rand. So because of this high exchange rate, this person, when he converts the $5,000 into a South African rand, he is going to get a lot of rands. By having a lot of rands, it means you have more buying power in South Africa. You see now, grade 12 learners, because this person now has got enough money or more money to buy because of the high exchange rate when converting the $5,000. So when we're talking of a buying power, we're actually talking that. And then there is also fluctuation. Fluctuation refers to daily change of the value of one currency against other currencies. So when you're talking of fluctuation, you're simply saying these foreign exchange, they go up and down. That is why you see that each and every day after the news, there is foreign exchange, because they want to keep us updated, because tourism is happening on a daily basis. So if we have people who are traveling on a daily basis coming from other countries, each and every day they will want to know, how much will I get when I exchange my currency? So what are the current exchange rates? That is why you see that information every day after the news. You see Great 12, because these exchange rates, they fluctuate, they go up and down. So that is why we are saying now, this refers to the daily change of the value of one currency against other currencies. So in our case, we always comparing our South African rand with the other currencies. For an example, if you say on a Monday, the exchange rate of a South African rand against a dollar is 18 rand. This is Monday. And then on a Tuesday, it is 17 rand 99 cents. That is your USD. And then let's use a GBP. GBP maybe on a Monday it is 22 rand 90 cents. On a Tuesday it is 23 rand 99 cents. So can you see now? These exchange rates are not stable. They fluctuate. On Monday, you see a different exchange rate. On a Tuesday, it's a different exchange rate. Here, for the pound, on a Monday, the exchange rate is different from the exchange rate that you see on a Tuesday. So that is why we are saying they fluctuate. That is why you must see these currencies every day. Because what is it that you are interested in as a tourist is to know, how much are you going to get in rands if you're converting your foreign currency into a rand? Or when you live in South Africa going to other countries, you are also interested to know, if you visit USA or you visit UK, how much are you going to get for your rands, like when you're converting your rands? You see now? So that is the whole idea of the fluctuation. We need to know every day what is happening with our currencies, because we know that they fluctuate. One day they are up, the other day they are down. So you need to know that information. Then grade 12 learners, now we are going to look at the GDP. We said GDP is the gross domestic product and its benefit to South African economy. So if you're talking of the GDP, the gross domestic product, what is its benefit to the South African economy? So now, there is GDP. It is important to note that any money spent by tourists in South Africa adds to the GDP and helps to grow the economy. So what are we saying now, grade 12 learners? Assuming that South Africa receives tourists from UK, from USA, from, I would say, European countries that are using a euro, the European Union. Maybe we can say European Union. So now, if South Africa receives tourists from these countries, and these people, they spend a lot of money in South Africa, at the end of the day, the tourism industry is going to make a lot of money. Foreign exchange income, we usually say that in tourism. So once we have more tourists visiting South Africa, at the end of the day, you are going to have more tourists spending their money in South Africa. So if we have more tourists spending more money in South Africa, it means the tourism industry is going to have more money and be able to contribute a lot to the GDP of the country. And if they're spending their money on South African goods and services, at the end of the day, that is going to help growing the economy of the country. So in tourism grade 12 learners, what we usually say is that let us have tourists coming to South Africa. SA Tourism must keep marketing South Africa so that many people are aware of South Africa as a country. They are aware of what South Africa can offer and they come to South Africa. But because once they get to South Africa, they will spend their money. And then that money is going to help contributing to the economy and also to the GDP of the country. So that is the whole idea. That is why we always talking of GDP and the economy in the country, because at the end of the day, we are aware that tourism is contributing a lot to the two, to the GDP and also to the economy of the country. That is very important, grade 12 learners. So now, while we are still on the GDP and its benefit to the South African economy, we are now going to look at the impact of the weakening GDP on the South African economy. What happens now whereby the GDP, like there is no many tourists coming in, they don't spend the money that you are expecting. You can imagine in 2020-21, during the COVID-19. So you can imagine what actually happened to the GDP and also the economy of the country. So that disease itself, it crippled the tourism industry, because once they say there is lockdown, it means there is no movement. And in tourism, we're talking of the movement of people from one place to another. So once now there is lockdown, everyone is locked at home and there is no movement, borders are closed, then what is going to happen to the tourism industry? That is why even today you can see that many people lost their jobs in tourism. Most tourism businesses are not in operation now. Airlines, you mean transport, accommodation, restaurants. So some of them really, they had it very tough during 2020 and 2021 because of that unforeseen occurrence that happened worldwide, because it was not only in South Africa, but we were affected as South Africans, because now we used to receive tourists from across the world. They come to South Africa, they experience what we have, they go to our attractions, they spend money in South Africa. Everything was well up until 2020 and 2021. So you can imagine now, grade 12 learners. So meaning that now during that period, there was a weakening of the GDP on the South African economy. So let us look now at the impacts. So obviously there was unemployment leading to rise in poverty, because most people in 2020, they were stopped from coming to work. Some were retrenched by the companies that closed down. Some salaries were cut down to most of the employees in South Africa, especially not only in the tourism industry, but our focus now is the tourism industry. So a lot has happened. You can imagine if you are used in getting a salary every month, then tomorrow you don't have a job. It means there is no salary. In fact, number one, there is unemployment now in the house, and there is no salary. Obviously, that is going to lead to poverty in so many households. So that was the situation. There's a lot of reasons that you can mention. I'm just mentioning COVID-19 because we are all aware of what happened during COVID-19 in South Africa. So investors will be less likely to invest in a country that is not expanding. You see, now remember, we do get money from the people who are investing in our country. So now they will be reluctant to invest in a country that they see it is not even expanding. People will have less money, or they will have less disposable income to spend. Disposable income was explained in grade 11 when you did domestic tourism growth strategy. So in those segments, in all the five segments, they're talking about disposable income. Spontaneous budget explorers, well-to-do Mzansi, you remember all those segments, they have a certain disposable income. So if now people their salaries are cut, people are not working, how on earth are they going to have a disposable income to spend? You see, a reversal of the multiplier effect. Remember, we said with the multiplier effect, it is when all the businesses involved in tourism are benefiting. So meaning that now, and I even made an example to say, if a tourist is in South Africa, that tourist is going to spend money on South African goods and services, and the people of South Africa will be employed to provide those goods and services and earn salaries and wages. So once they get their salaries and their wages, obviously they're going to spend their own salaries. So you see now there's this circulation of money. Everyone benefits in the process. Now, can you imagine if now we don't have tourists coming in, or we have less tourists coming in? It is a disaster altogether. So there's going to be a reversal of the multiplier effect. Price increases for goods and services. It is so unfortunate, grade 12 learners, that when we're talking of the price increases, even if we can say we have a global event in South Africa, during that global event, prices obviously they increase. They not only affecting the tourists, but they affect everyone. Whether you're working or you're not working, the price increases for goods and services, they affect all South Africans, including the tourists that are coming in. So now, these are the impacts, grade 12 learners. When you go back to them, please, because these were taken straight from a previous question paper as they are. So it means that you must know the question papers, they do ask these questions. And that is why I said to you earlier on, there is no way when we're talking of foreign exchange, we're only focusing on calculations, because there is a lot that can still give you the marks instead of doing the calculation. Sometimes you find that calculations are only for 3 marks each. Maybe you are only given 2 calculations, so it's 3 marks, only 6 marks. And then question 3 is talking of foreign exchange, the whole of the question. Maybe you find that the question is out of 21. And then the rest of the marks, where are you going to get them? You're going to get them from these concepts or the terminology that we are doing here. So it is very important that you take these very serious. I'm not saying you shouldn't take the calculation serious, but I'm saying to you, there's a lot that can still give you the marks instead of the calculations, because our learners, in most cases, they focus on calculations only and forget that there is a lot that can give you a marks. And then now we're going to look at the multiplier effect and its link to the GDP. The multiplier effect and its link to the GDP. So remember, we've already touched on that. Remember, grade 12 learners, every rand spent by a tourist doesn't just benefit the first place to receive that money, but also multiple businesses and members of the community. You see now, I did explain to you that when you're talking of a multiplier effect, I remember in the past, we used to have this, whereby at the top you say you have a tourist visiting South Africa, and then that tourist is going to spend, we're always talking about expenditure, that tourist is going to spend his or her money on SA goods and services. You see, and then here, who is providing the goods and the services? It is South Africans who are employed. So these South Africans are employed to do what? To provide these goods and the services. And then here, the very South Africans, they will spend, because they're getting their wages and salaries, so they will spend their wages and salaries on so many things. Remember, there is housing or accommodation, they're paying bonds, they're paying rent, they're paying for education, they pay for groceries. So you can name everything they're spending their salaries on. Above all, they pay taxes to the government. And then what the government does with the taxes. Remember, that is why each and every year we have a budget speech in February in South Africa. From that budget speech, the taxes are also included. So now, at the end of the day, that money that is collected from the taxes and the people who are working, who are paying taxes and so forth, that money is going to be used maybe to build infrastructure in South Africa. And then who benefits at the end of the day? Great job. When the tourists are in your country, and maybe there was a global event in South Africa, so the roads were built, accommodation establishments were renovated, so there was a lot of development in the infrastructure. Who is going to benefit at the end of the day? It is not the tourists, it is the South Africans, because tourists are not going to take those infrastructure away with them back to their countries. It is that infrastructure is going to be left in your country, and you are going to benefit in your country. So that is why today we have a lot of development in the infrastructure, and it is used by South Africans. So at the end of the day, the local community benefits. So this is just my example of a multiplier effect. So it means, now if you see this picture here, we have a tourist there. So we also have a tourist there. So we are saying all the money that is circulating here, initially it came from a tourist. So it is going to benefit these people, but at the end of the day, there is a lot of people who are going to benefit from the multiplier effect. So you need to take that into consideration, and maybe you come up with your own example of a multiplier effect, because I've seen many question papers. You find that for you to be able to explain a multiplier effect, you need to come up with an example. So you can use a hotel as an example. You can use a restaurant as an example. Whatever tourism business that a tourist can use, you can use it as your own example to explain the multiplier effect.